How but this word go forth, you would never be the same. I declare and I decree, the hunger that we lost would be birthed back in you today. I declare and I decree, and he said, whatsoever I decree, it shall be established this morning. And I decree and I declare, the thirst that we have lost for God would be birthed back in our system like never before. And if you believe that, come on and clap one more time for the Lord. Hallelujah. 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 And in the name of Jesus Christ, I come against the spirit of heaviness. They may try to rest upon you that you may not receive this word. I come against the spirit of tiredness that often comes when the preached word goes forth. In the name of Jesus, I release a refreshing upon you in the name of Jesus, that you may be refreshed to receive like never before. Hallelujah. We thank God, don't we? My Lord, my God. God have given me a word. It is a life-changing word. It is a word where God have allowed us to go into the mind of Satan. It's a word where we shall be liberated. Can I tell you that God will expose the spirit of error that have kept the church bound for years? And after this word go forth, you shall see how the enemy had us as a church bound. God gave me this word 3 weeks ago. And then God put a demand on this word. Already this word have went forth twice in this city in 3 weeks at two different churches. And I thought that maybe what God says, I would preach at my home church, well, maybe it'll be a different word. But God would not allow me to deviate from this word. It is a word of revelation knowledge. It's a rhema word. It's a word that God revealed to me through revelation knowledge. And whenever God give us a rhema word, a word that is revealed, it is precious. It is special. And it is continually to be pursued. This is why he has summoned me to preach this word again after it have went forth. Now, when we say revelation knowledge is what brings change. Can we have the lights turned on, please? Revelation knowledge is what have us to go from glory to glory and from faith to faith. It is a word where you will hear that God is seeking for his spiritual midwives. My God. Whenever we study, what 2 Timothy tells us in 2:15, study to show ourselves approved. A workman, sons and daughters, need not to be ashamed of the word of God, but we know how to rightly divide the word of God. As we study and meditate, now God is not impressed with us reading the Bible in 1 year. That is good, but it's not God's perfect will. His perfect will is that we read and study his word. And as we read, study, and meditate on his word, then the seed of this word is implanted deep within our spirit. Okay? Twofold. After we read, study, and meditate on the written word of God, the Logos word of God, and as we take it to the secret place, the place that the enemy knows not, a place where Psalm of Solomon 2:14 said it's the cliffs in the rock. Where Matthew 6:6 said, go into your own room, close the door, pray to me in secret, God said, and I will reward you openly. Psalms 91, he or she that live in the secret place should abide under the shadow of the Almighty God. Now, as we study, read, and meditate on the Word of God and get along with God in a secret place, it is then the seed of that Word is birthed in our spirit and begin to illuminate in our soulless realm, which is the mind, the will, the emotions. And this is how revelation knowledge is birthed. This is where change taking place in our lives. Too long we read the Word of God, but it have not brought change, because we have missed the twofold purpose. We study, we read, we meditate, then we go alone and spend time with God. That's when the Word of God become alive and sharper and powerful than any two-double-edged sword that person even between the stunder of the soul and the spirit and the joint and the marrow. If we are not receiving revelation knowledge, church, we're dying. You hear what I said? If we're not receiving revelation knowledge, the revealed Word of God that comes as I study and read and spend time with God, if we're not doing that, we're not receiving revelation knowledge for change. We got to have revelation knowledge in these last days. And giving honor to Pastor Miller and Sister Miller, and they're absent as we continue to pray for our pastor and our first lady. I give an honor to my dear wife, hallelujah. She's definitely a gift to me, praise God, to my children. My granddaughter's here today, praise God. To my sister-in-law I see over there, to my brothers, to my uncles, auntie, to you, New Life. Another opportunity, and it's just that, an opportunity that I do not take lightly. This word will change your life. And every time I mount God's platform, I'm always aware that the Word of God got to come to me before it come through me. Revelation knowledge. The book of Deuteronomy, you have to turn to. I will tell you what scripture to turn to. Let me please have your undivided attention. I would greatly appreciate it. Deuteronomy 29 and 29 tells us the secret things belong to the Lord. But God said, what I reveal, revelation knowledge, it is for us and for our children forever. Matthew 16 and 13. After the disciples have been spending time with Jesus, Jesus asked his disciples, who do men say that I am? The disciples said, well, some said you're Elijah. Some said you're John the Baptist. Some said you're Jeremiah. And Jesus said, well, who do you say I am? Peter said, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Jesus said to Peter, flesh and blood have not revealed, for revelation knowledge, flesh and blood have not revealed this to you, only my Father in heaven. And then Jesus said, upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell should not prevail against that. Yes, the name Peter means rock, but Jesus Christ was not building the church on the name of Peter. He was building the church on the rock of revelation knowledge that Peter had received. 1 Corinthians 2 and 9. Eyes have not seen, ears have not heard, neither have entered to the hearts of men the things that God got for them that love them, but God have again revealed them to us by his Spirit. It is the deep things that search our inward parts of the belly. Revelation knowledge is what we must receive. John 15 and 7, listen to this. Jesus said, if you abide in me, and my word abide in you, then you can ask what you will, and it shall be given. We've been missing this, saints. It is a twofold purpose to receive from God. Study, meditate on the word, take it to prayer. God have given me this word of revelation knowledge through a prophetic vision. I was at work, working, minding my business. And all of a sudden, God shift my mind. Put this post up, the preacher. It was a prophetic vision of the 1975 Jaws movie poster. Now, as I'm looking at this in the vision, it was like I'm watching TV. This This is the vision. Make it larger if you can. This is the vision. Good. I was looking at while I was at work. This nowhere on my mind. I hadn't seen this movie, but all of a sudden I'm at work. And God shift my mind to this poster. Now, as I'm looking at this in the vision, all of a sudden, the machine I was working on broke down. So it shifted me out of the vision. And to be honest with you, after working on the machine and working the 8 hours, I've kind of forgotten about that vision. You got to hear this. The next day, I went with my wife to Fort Wayne on her bi-monthly business trip. And as we got to Fort Wayne, we stopped at TGI Fridays to get some lunch. As we went in TGI Fridays and sat down, and if you ever been to TGI Fridays in Fort Wayne, on one of their walls, they have old collectibles. So I'm sitting down and I'm looking at the old collectibles on the wall. In the upper left-hand corner, it was this poster. And I said to Kelly, I said, whoa, babe. I said, that's the poster that God gave me a vision about. Well, after being married with me for so long, and God, Kelly kind of used to my godly moments, she wasn't impressed. And I'm continuously staring at this poster. Now I know that God is impressing upon me to get along with him, that he may reveal to me what he's trying to say. As I got along with God, go into your own room, close the door, pray to me in secret, son, and I shall reward you openly. As I'm hearing God in prayer, he says, son, I want to speak to you about my church. He said, the water in this poster that I gave you a vision about is symbolic and represent my word. Ephesians 5, verse 25. Husbands, love your wife as Christ loved the church and cleansed her, sanctified her, and washed her with the water of the word. So the water symbolic of the word of God. Well, he said, the woman that's swimming on the top surface of the water, it's my church, the bride of Christ. Again, Ephesians 5 and 25. Husband, love your wife as Christ loved the church and sanctified her, washed her, cleaned her. So the woman's symbolic of the bride of Christ, us, the church. Well, I said, well, God, I know then if the water's symbolic of the word and the woman is symbolic of the church, and I know John's is symbolic of the devil. He said, no, no, son. John's is symbolic of the spin of error that has been assigned to the church by Satan. And if you notice, the spin of error is deep within the word of God. You notice the woman, the church is swimming on the top surface of the word of God. 2 Timothy 3. God said, well, let me back up. Spirit of error. 1 John 4 and 6. God said, we should know the spirit of truth and the spirit of error. Okay? Then he said in 2 Timothy 3, in the last days, perilous time should come. And we're living in the last days, folks. We're living in the last days. He said, the last days, perilous time should come. Then verse 5 and 7 applies to us, the church. Verse 5 said, in the last day, we, the church, will have a form of godliness, but we will deny the power thereof. Why, God? Because verse 7 goes on to say, we will be forever learning, never come into the knowledge. What knowledge, God? Revelation knowledge of truth. He went on to say, we the church, we are continuously swimming on the top surface of the water, when I told you in my word, Psalms 42:7, we got to go beneath the surface where the deep calls unto the deep at the sounds of the waterfall. What are you saying, God? At the sounds of my word. He says, son, tell my people, when you study and meditate on my word and take it to me in the secret place, he says, it's then that you speak my word. And if you speak my word, said God, he said, Jeremiah 1, he said, I'll watch, I hasten my word to perform it. As you begin to speak it out your mouth, he's not a man that he shall lie, or the son of man that he shall repent. Had you speak the word of God, it shall manifest in your life. For too long, we've been swimming on the top surface of the word of God, while the spirit of error have gone deep. And while we're on the top surface, we cannot see the spirit of error because we're swimming on shallow ground. And God says, it's time to go beneath the surface of my word. And the enemy have convinced us that the word of God is a religious thing. God, I speak, but I don't see nothing. God, I'm speaking healing, but I'm not receiving. God, I'm speaking financial manifestation, but God, I'm not receiving. God, I'm speaking the word over my marriage, but I'm not receiving. God says, stand and meditate and take it to the secret place. Too long, we've been swimming on the top surface of the word of God. Can I tell you some, church? What God told me. Now mind you, I'm not the preacher that will mount God's platform and say God said when he really not have spoken to me. I would not impress you and lie on God. Even the spirit of error have come upon us to make us lose reverence for God. To say God said, and God really have not said. Listen to this. Ezekiel 13:7. God said, it is lying divination to say God said when I have not spoken. And understand, lying divination, he talking about the spirit of lying and the demonic spirit of divination. That's within Acts 16, where Paul cast out the spirit of divination out of this lady. So we got to be certain to hear from God. God said to me, after still giving me interpretation of this poster, oh, you got to hear this. He said, son, one of the oldest, most diabolical demonic assignment from the spirit of error that had been released to the church by Satan. He said, one of the oldest, most diabolical assignment, listen to this, is to deny are to keep the man of God. And when I say man of God, I'm not talking about the man of God just mount this platform. When I say the man of God, I'm talking from the pew to the pulpit, from the youngest naturally to the oldest naturally, to the youngest spiritually who just gave his life to Christ, to the oldest spiritually who gave his life to Christ years ago. I'm talking and including every man of God. He says, son, one of the oldest, most diabolical demonic assignment from the spirit of error that been assigned to the church. No. If you're on your phone, please let it be you looking up the word of God. Don't be on no phone texting and having a conversation. Give him reverence. Give him reverence. Yes, God. He said one of the oldest, most diabolical demonic plan from the spirit of error that been released to the church is to keep from the man of God revelation knowledge of his true identity in Christ. Then the spirit of error would then use that man of God to deny the woman of God her spiritual office within a corporate setting. Well, preacher, you got to reveal that even more. One of, God said, and I heard it in my spirit, and it came to my mind. He said, one of the oldest, most diabolical, demonic method or assignment or scheme from the spirit of error that have been assigned to the church by Satan is to keep from us, the man of God, revelation knowledge of our true identity in him, then use that same man of God to deny the woman of God her spiritual office in the church. Revelation 2 and 24, God talking to the church. He said, we don't know the depths of Satan. Lord, what do you mean we don't know the depths of Satan? He said, once we open that door, on whatever level of sin it is, from fornication, adultery, to cussing somebody out, it does not matter the level. And the greatest sin is prayerlessness. Because if Satan can keep us out of the secret place, then every other sin is just a manifestation of us not praying. And look at this. He will use your children. He will use your husband. He will use your wife to keep you from God. Revelation 2 and 4, he said, we don't know the depths of the enemy. What are you saying, God? Because once we give in to that sin, we are unconscious of what's going on in the spiritual realm, in that second heaven. Because we're so blinded and satisfying our fleshly desires on this earth level, but in the second heaven, things are being worked against us. And we have no clue. Because we can't see it with the physical eyes. He said, you got to hear this, Proverbs 12 and 15. God said, a fool. Listen to this. He said, a fool ways seem right to him. But it's the wise son and daughter that listen to the counsels of God. I'm finna show you one scripture. There's many scriptures Satan will try to use. But I'm going to show you one scripture where the spirit of error had the church bound for years. Can I tell you something? Many mothers and daughters of Zion have went to their graves being bound by this one scripture, because the spirit of error used that man of God from receiving revelation knowledge of his true identity and kept back that woman of God from having revelation knowledge of her first ordained office. And can I tell you something? I'm not talking about the office of the fivefold ministry. Thank God we have women pastors, women teachers, women's evangelists. But there's one office Satan made sure that the women's of God never receive revelation, knowledge about. And he used that man of God to deny them in a corporate body. Turn with me. 1 Corinthians 14. 1 Corinthians 14. Many mothers and daughters of Zion have went to their grave. Many men of God have went through their grave, been bound by the spirit of error. This is why Hosea 4 and 6 said, God said, my people die from the lack of knowledge. What knowledge, God? Revelation knowledge. 1 Corinthians 14, 34, 35, every woman of God should know this scripture. Can I tell you, my dear mother, that's in heaven right now, did not mount a platform to preach because the man of God was deceived from receiving revelation knowledge from this scripture. Let your women keep silent in the churches, for it is not permitted unto them to speak. But they are commanded to be under obedience, as also said the law. 35. And if they will learn anything, my God, let them ask their husbands at home. For it's a shame for women to speak in the church. What? Can the word of God out from you or came unto you only? Now let's get liberated. Because the spirit of error have kept many mothers and daughters of Zion from many platforms of the fivefold office that a pastor, teacher, evangelist, But the main office, the spirit of error that has been sent by Satan to attack the church, to deny the man of God his true identity, and then use that man of God to come against the woman of God for finding her first office, is the main key. Now let's dissect this. 1 Corinthians. Let me first give you a little history on the Corinthians, the city of Corinth. At this time, it was the largest and richest city in the Roman Empire. It was the wealthiest. It was one of the most paganism cities in the Roman Empire. They had a statue on the hill of a pagan goddess that they would worship. And a home beside the statues was a house that housed 1,000 prostitutes. Well, Paul, who was a missionary, was there for 18 months as a tent maker. And Paul knew, if I can start the church as an apostle, this would be the ideal city, because the whole city was bound. So for 18 months, Paul, the apostle Paul, established a church in Corinth. While he was there, he raised up Aquila and Priscilla to pastor that church. Then Paul left and went to Ephesus. Well, before Priscilla and Aquila left, they raised up Apollos to be the pastor. Well, while Paul was in Ephesus, he get a letter from the household of Chloe saying this: the church that you established is a mess. Sexual immorality all in the church. Clicks and nicks all in the church. He said, she said, all in the church. No love of God, all in the church. Now you got to agree with me, that sounds a lot like today's church. Well, Paul began to write back. Let me bring you up to this. Chapter 1 through chapter 4 of 1 Corinthians, Paul responded back to the letter that the household of Chloe wrote him concerning the church. Paul goes on to tell them about his own ministry and his missionary journey. Chapter 5 and 6, Paul wrote to them concerning and making statements about what they wrote to him. Now he's getting ready to address the situation or the devil that was in the church. And it was the spirit of error. Now I do admit the women's was raising up, being outspoken. But let me tell you something. It was so much other mess that was going on. So I want you to turn with me to chapter 7 of 1 Corinthians. This is the scripture that the spirit of error for years have kept the church in bondage. And it's sad that many of mothers of Zion, again, have went to their grave, never been liberated. And can I tell you, that spirit of error is still alive and well in some denominations. Women of God can't mount platforms because of the spirit of error, and mainly because of this scripture. Now, chapter 7 of 1 Corinthians, it starts off verse 1 saying, now concerning the things whereas you wrote unto me. Now, Paul is saying, I'm getting ready to address things going on in the church that you wrote to me about. Yes? Okay? Turn with me. Chapter 11. And we're going to look at verse 3. Chapter 11 of 1 Corinthians, verse 3. But I will have you to know that the head of every man is Christ, and the head of every woman is man, and the head of Christ is God. Verse 4. For every man praying a prophesying, have his head covered, dishonor his head. Now, Paul is dealing with cultures at this time. Verse 5. But every woman that prayed and prophesied with her head uncovered, dishonor her head, For that is even all one as if she was shaven. Paul is dealing with cultures saying the man should have his head covered. Shouldn't have his head covered, but the woman should. But you see no time that Paul said woman should not speak or prophesy. Yes? So that right there alone killed that theology that said women should keep quiet in the church. Well, now let's go to 14. Now, I'm going to read 34 and 35. I want every woman of God, after I read verse 34 and 35 of 1 Corinthians 14, I want every woman of God to read the first word in verse 36. Now, I want you to read it or speak it exactly the way Paul wrote it in verse 36. You see, here is a question mark behind the what in 36. Some version Bibles have an exclamation point. Okay? Now, I'm getting ready to read 34 and 35. Now, let me explain this. 34 and 35, written by Paul, it was written as quotations. They didn't have quotation marks in Greek and Hebrew at that time. So Paul rewrote what they wrote to him first to remind them what I'm getting ready to address. The spirit of error have used the man of God and the woman of God to say women can speak in the church. And at today's time, that scripture of error is still alive because some men of God have kept the woman of God from mounting platforms. Again, this scripture is written as quotation, as a repeat what they first wrote to Paul. Now, when I finish reading 34 and 35, every woman, I want you to say the first word in 36, and you got to say it like this. What? Negative response. In other words, are you crazy? That's the way Paul wrote it. Are you ready, woman of God? Let's practice. When I count to three, I want you to say it as he written it. One, two, three. Just like that. Now let's read 34 and 35. Let your women keep silent in the churches, for it is not permitted unto them to speak, but as they are commanded to be under obedience, as also said the law. And if they will learn anything, let them ask their husband at home. It is a shame for women to speak in the church. Just like that. Then Paul goes on to say in 36, now he's getting ready to rebuke them. He said, came the word of God out from you, or it came unto you only? In other words, man of God, do you think the word of God was for you only? That's what he's saying. Look at 37. If any man think himself to be a prophet or spiritual, let him acknowledge the theme that I already wrote, Paul said. Unto you are the commandments of the Lord. And look what he said in 38. But if any man be ignorant, then go on to be ignorant then. And many men of God have been ignorant in the word of God that have kept the woman of God or denied the woman of God her spiritual office in their corporate body. That's the spirit of error that's been released in the body of Christ by Satan. Now, you got to look with me. If you look at church history, if you look at me, I'm about to wrap this up. If you look with me with church history, you have to agree that the women of God have far outnumbered the men of God in the churches. You got me from day one. Well, as the generations that's coming up, men's have been prayed into the church. More men are coming into the church. Thank God for that. They've been prayed in by mamas and grandmothers and aunties and sisters. And more of us are coming into the church. Women's, we're coming. We're coming. But can I tell you something? The moment the man of God come into the church, immediately he's attacked. Immediately. You may ask, why is that? 1 Corinthians 11, you don't have to turn there, 3. And I read it earlier. It said that Christ is the head of man. Man is the head of wife. God is the head of Christ. That's the divine order of God in the marriage as well as the church in that one scripture. Now the spirit of error quickly attack marriages to disarray or dismantle the order of God in the marriage. What are you saying, preacher? The spirit of error quickly seduced the woman of God to say or take the position as the head of the household. That's not the order of God. That woman seduced by a spirit of error and a seducing spirit. Prime example, King Ahab and Jezebel. Jezebel been seduced by the spirit of error, been seduced by a seducing spirit. She was a self-centered, self-willed, domineering wife to a moral weakling as a husband. She not only seduced him for the position, but she seduced everyone in the sin of Israel, killing everyone that got in her way. When you have a marriage that's not in the divine order of God, then understand something. That King Ahab spirit that's upon the husband, he will have a heart pretending to know God and love the things of God. But because he's not in position, he will have a heart for the things of this world. Money, cars, houses, land, sports, you name it. Because he's out of order. This can be traced back to our ancestors, Adam and Eve. Satan, on purpose, went to Eve to get her first out of the divine order of God. Hurry up with the spirit of error. Did God really say you must not eat from the tree of the garden? She said, well, we can eat from every tree of the garden except for the tree in the middle of the garden. Satan said, now you can eat from that tree, for God knows that if you eat from that, you will be just like him. Satan was deep within the word of God, while Eve was on the top surface of the word of God. And with that, she was deceived. Can I tell you something? When we as the men of God come into the church, woman of God, after being prayed by mama, grandma, auntie, and as we come into the church, can I tell you, listen, demonic hierarchy demons that are quickly attached to the man of God? Number one, we just heard the spirit of error. Number two, demonic hierarchy, the demonic spirit of whoredom, quickly attacked the man of God when he come into the church. What's the spirit of whoredom? Every sexual immorality act that you can think of come under the heading of the demonic hierarchy of the demon of whoredom. Fornication, adultery, pornography, you name it. That spirit quickly attacked the man of God along with the spirit of error. The spirit of bondage quickly attacked the man of God as he come into the church. What's the spirit of bondage? The spirit of bondage, his assignment is to bring man back to what God delivered him from when he was in the world. Now that he's in the church, the spirit of bondage tried to get him to draw back on God, to go back to something you're familiar with, alcohol, drugs, running wild women, spirit of error, spirit of whoredom, spirit of bondage. Well, there's about three more that has attached themselves quickly to attack the man of God. The spirit of pride. When God blesses the man of God to show his approval that you're in the right place, God bless him, maybe with cars, houses, and land. Then the spirit of pride have him worshiping what God gave him as a blessing, the job, the house, the money, and then we hear more about the blessing than we do about God. That's the spirit of pride. Where you find the spirit of pride, you will find the spirit of lying and the spirit of jealousy upon the man of God. Now, I can almost go with jealousy upon a woman. But when a man of God allows jealousy to come upon him, that's a shame before God, because he has to be the head. These are the demonic hierarchies that quickly attack themselves to the man of God upon their mindset. And I asked God, I said, Lord, how is it that the man of God, how is it that we so easily deceive? Again, when I say man of God, I'm talking from the pew to the pulpit. How is it, God, that when we come into the church and we try to find you, God, how is it, God, that the demon of whordom quickly attached himself to me and we look around in the church to try to lay some woman down? How quickly, God, when we come into the church, the spirit of bondage is upon me, trying to get me back to what you delivered me from. How is it, God, that when I come into the church, the spirit of lying is upon me to impress one another? How is it, God, when I come into the church, the spirit of pride is upon me? How is this, God? You want to know how easy it is for the man of God to stay up on a Saturday night and watch movie and be so tired not to come to church? It's a demon that's been influencing him. It ain't nothing in the flesh. We wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and power, rulers of darkness and spirit wickedness in heavenly realms. Though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. The weapon of warfare is not carnal. It's mighty through God and pulling down the demonic strongholds that will allow Satan upon our mindset to capture. How is it that I can stay home and watch my favorite ball game and not come to church when God said, forsake not the assembly of joining yourself with other believers, because I know what you're going through. I know you need to be encouraged. But God, I choose to be influenced by a demon and make me stay home. And then I got the audacity to you and tell you to bless me. That's a seducing spirit. My people die from the lack of knowledge. Revelation, knowledge. I ask God, how is it that we so deceive God? And you got to hear this. He said, Deacon Lyle, we ask the man of God, why we so easily deceive, why we so easily deceived by these spirits upon us. Listen to this. He said, when we came into the church, we was birthed out of our soulish realm and not out of our spirit. What do you mean, God? We came into the church, birthed out of our soulish realm. We came in the church knowing all about God, but not knowing God. We were birthed out of our soul, our mind, our will, and our emotions. We came into the church knowing about God, but we didn't know God from the secret place, because no demons made sure that we didn't spend time with him. So we come into the church, we know too much, men of God. We know too much. We know too much about God and don't know God. Can I tell you something? From Pastor Miller to T.D. Jakes and from many other preachers, they can never teach or preach you to know God. They can tell you all about God, but to know God for yourself, baby, you got to spend time with him. And the demon of error makes sure that we don't do this. Can I tell you something? I love that woman right there, Kelly. But let me tell you something. When I stand before God, she will not be standing with me. Can I tell you something? That husband that you're clinging to, that wife that you're clinging to, you will not stand with them before God. He said, work out your own soul salvation. Jesus, help us, God. How is it? How is it, God, that we can be so deceived in the church? He said, we were birthed out of our soul and not out of our spirit. What are you saying, God? When we are birthed of our soul based on what we know and not out of the spirit, There's no substance. There's no roots. So we wonder why it's so easy we can do the very thing we hate. How is it, God, that I can hear Pastor Miller preach? How is it I can come to Bible study? But when temptation presents itself, it's so easy for me to give in to God. Why is that? He said, you know too much. You know all about me, but don't know me. You've been birthed out of your soul, your mind, your will, your emotion. But you were never birthed out from my spirit. Let's fix this. God said, the spirit of travail have come upon the man in this season. Understand, God worked with his people through seasons. So like in the natural season, you got winter, you got fall, you got summer. God, in this season, have allowed the spirit, hear this, I'm not talking about religious thing. I'm not preaching to your soul to make you happy. I'm preaching to your spirit to create a divine hunger for God. Folks, we have lost our hunger for God. We have lost our thirsting for God. And God says, I'm seeking your availability to be with me. It's not your ability, it's your availability that I seek. And we lost it. For this world system, it grieves God when we spend time with the worldly things and not with him. Keep playing Christian. He's grieved. And we wonder, God, why is it I'm about to lose my mind when I'm trying to live holy? And I find myself doing the very thing I hate. How is it so easy, God? I repent of a thing, but do it anyway. Because you've been birthed out of a soul and out of your spirit. He said, son, tell my church in this season, man of God, listen. He said, the spirit of travail I have released upon the man of God. And he said, it's foreign to us as the man of God. Travail is that of a woman giving natural birth to a child. It's a pushing. And God said, I have released the spirit of travail upon the man. But he said, that man of God is stuck in the spiritual birth canal. And God said, he is an unwise son because he don't know when to be birthed out. He's stuck in the spiritual birth canal because he knows so much. And then he took me to the book of Hosea. Put it up, preacher. Hosea 13 and 13. You got to see this. Understand, when God speaks, Isaiah 28 says, precepts upon precepts, line upon line, here a little, there a little. He said, the man of God, I have released the spirit of travail upon my sons. But he said, they're stuck in the spiritual birth canal. I have opened up the womb of the spirit for them to be birthed out. But he said, because we know so much, we're stuck. Look at Hosea 13 and 13. He said, the sorrows of travailing woman shall come upon him. He is an unwise son, for he should not stay alone in the place of breaking forth children. And God is saying, man of God, you trying to figure this thing out that's going on with yourself, with your family, and with your finance. You'll put down your own three-year goals and your five-year goals. But you left out the common denominator, and that's God. He said, we're stuck in the spiritual birth canal. We're churching it, but there's no love relationship with God. And in that birth canal, we're trying to get out, but we're stuck. And the womb of the spirit is open. But God said, because you know so much, because you're so smart. And he said, the foolish things of mine is wiser than any man. Look what he said. Look at Isaiah. Woman of God, this is what you got to do for your husband, for your son, for your grandson, for your niece, your nephew. This is what you have to do for us, woman of God. Because the spirit of error made sure that he used the man of God to deny the woman of God her spiritual office. Isaiah 66. Who have heard such a thing? Who have seen such things? Shall the earth be made to bring forth in one day? Or shall a nation be born at once? For as soon as Zion, what? Travail, she brought forth her children. Shall I bring to birth and not cause to bring forth? Shall the Lord, said the Lord, shall I cause to bring forth and shut the womb, said God? Woman of God, you cannot fix a spiritual situation through natural means. You can't fight flesh with spirit. It's spirit to spirit. Woman of God, you see the condition of your husband. You see the condition of your fiance, your son, your grandson, your nephews. You see the conditions. But if you don't birth it out in the spirit, he will never be birthed out. Can I tell you something? You ain't gonna never feel like going into the birthing room. It ain't easy laying in the hospital, woman, and birthing children in the natural. And it ain't easy going to the spiritual birthing place. But God have called you, woman of God, to be his spiritual midwife. What are you saying, preacher? What are you saying, spiritual midwife? Woman of God, your first ordained office from God is to be a spiritual midwife, to birth out your family, to birth out your husband, to birth out your fiance, your grandson, your nephew. And that have nothing to do with your degrees, have nothing to do with your high school diploma, but have everything to do with you and God. Why sit there and let him die? Why sit there and allow him to die when God called you to be his spiritual midwife? What are you talking about, preacher? Get it up to Exodus chapter 1. What are you talking about, preacher? I never heard such a thing. God's spiritual midwife. What you talking about, preacher? God's spiritual midwife. God said for years, the church been in bondage. For years, we have allowed the spirit of error to keep us from finding out your spiritual office. Woman of God, I want to be the first man of God. On behalf of all the men, we are sorry for denying you your first spiritual office. We were deceived by the spirit of error. We did not know. Now is today for your liberation. This is your first spiritual office, not by man, but by God. Exodus chapter 1. Listen what God said. And the king of Egypt spoke to the Hebrew midwife, of which the name of one of them was Shiphrah, and the other was Puah. And he said, when you do the what? When you do the what? When you do the office, it is the same office of that of a pastor, teacher, apostle, prophet, evangelist. It is the same office. He said, when you do the office of a midwife to the Hebrew women, see them upon the stools. The stools represent the altar. The stools where the woman was impregnated, she would sit upon the stools like that of a toilet seat, but it was bricks. And the Hebrew pregnant woman would sit upon the bricks. And God's midwife would say, push. I know it's painful, but push. Jesus, wait, what are you saying? He said, if it be a son,
you shall kill him. Jesus. But if it be a daughter, then you shall let her live. What are you saying? But the midwife feared God and did not what the king of Egypt commanded them, but saved the men children alive. And the king of Egypt called God's midwife on the carpet and said to them, why have you done this thing and have saved the men children alive? And the midwife said unto Pharaoh, because of the Hebrew women, they are not as the Egyptian women, for they are lively and they are delivered early. The midwife come unto them. Therefore God dealt with them, dealt with the midwife and the people, and multiplied and waxed them very mightily. And it came to pass, because of God, the midwife feared God. This is what God did. He blessed them with their own houses. He said, king of Egypt said, kill the men. It was never meant for the man of God to come into the house of God. He said, kill the men, children. Why? Let the daughters live. What are you saying, God? Because the method was, kill the men, children. But the women, let them live. Because we're going to indoctrinate them with the spirit of error. We're going to get an Egyptian man to get them to mate with the Hebrew women. And in that way, their children will worship Egyptian gods. Can I tell you something, woman of God? The word of God, Egypt, means worldly. To this day, worldly men are coming into the house of God who don't want God. And the women of God, the men of this world, worldly men who don't have a desire for God, come into the house of God and pulling the women out of their position with God. Seducing them, luring them, dating them, to pull them away from God. Worldly Egyptian men. Kill the men. Let the women live. Can I tell you something? Woman of God, God is seeking out spiritual midwife. He called his daughters back home. We have allowed the spirit of error to make sure you, woman of God, never find out your first office. And all these years, you've been trying to make something happen through the arm of the flesh. It's not your money. It's not your ideology. But it's you being used in the office of God's midwife. Can I tell you something? God's midwife, she is not born, she is not made, she is raised from the secret place of God. Can I tell you something about God's spiritual midwife? She's consecrated. She lives in holiness to the highest degree. Can I tell you something? God is seeking out his spiritual midwives. You'll never find her in clicks and nicks. Can I tell you something about God's midwife? Every morning, the Holy Ghost dresses her. Can I tell you something about God's spiritual midwife? She lives in the secret place. Psalms 91. When God tell her to fast, how long, God? Maybe for hours. Maybe for days, maybe for months, however long to birth out the family, however long to birth out my son from drugs, however long to birth out my husband from the spirit of pornography, from the spirit of whoredom, from the spirit of him being ignorant. God's spiritual midwife, she makes sure that she searches the atmosphere against spiritual abortions. What spiritual abortion? When God give the church to birth out something new, God's spiritual midwife, stand as an intercessor between Satan and what that church is birthing out. God's spiritual midwife, catch the vision of the pastor and birth it out. She stands against spiritual stillborn. What are you talking about? Spiritual stillborn. She pray against when the church is giving all their time and energy to a religious thing, a tradition thing that been dead for years. She makes sure that she bring life to that thing. God's spiritual midwife standing a gap against spiritual dryness when the church ain't growing. When the church at a mundane place, God's spiritual midwife got a high degree of discerning of the spirit, discerning what's going on in the church atmosphere, and take it to the birthing room. And God is singing out his spiritual midwife. Where have the mother boys went? The mother boys, where are they? The one need a bindums, where are they? The Sydney trim, where are they? New life. God is seeking out his spiritual midwife. And God is saying, woman of God, it's time to pull from this world. It's time to pull from this world system. It's time to pull out for what you think is important. But God said, go back to the birthing room. Because that thing that you want to see in your family will only be birthed out in the birthing room, where you go into your own room and you close your door and you pray to your father in secret. Why allow us as the men of God to sit there and die? Can I tell you something? It's in the midnight hour where you lay in slumber and sleeping. The Spirit of God never sleeps. And in a minute hour, he's seeking, searching the hearts of his daughters. He's searching the hearts to raise you up as his spiritual midwife. Man can ordain you in this office. You cannot ordain yourself. Only God can raise you up after the test to be God's spiritual midwife. He's going to allow you to know that you're being talked about. He's going to allow you to know that you're being hated. But it's only a test of your faith to produce patience to wait on him. Too long, woman of God, we have allowed the spirit of error to deny your office. Your office, woman of God, is that of spiritual midwife. Man of God, we're stuck in the spiritual birth canal. And it's time to let go your theology. And it's time for you, us, to spend time with God, to be birthed out again. Paul said, I travail, Galatians 4 and 19. Paul said, I travail into Christ. Be formed in you again. What are you doing in the midnight hour? God is seeking in the midnight hour. Come out. He's seeking in the midnight hour for you to be birthed out. Let this flow. Let it be a flow. Midwife.
Till day, there is no fear. see you on your knees. It must be midnight. I know you're sad, but I'm so glad you took the time out to call me. Oh yeah. You must be in trouble. Came on the double. Midnight's the only time that I can hear from you. Oh, how I wish you'd call me when your skies are blue. Don't wait,
midnight.
Don't wait, don't wait, don't wait, no, no. Like you're using me and taking me for granted. I'm more than a savior, more than a way maker. Please let me show you.
In the name of Jesus, we thank you, Lord. Father, we give you praise. Everyone standing, let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, we thank you. The Father, you're seeking out in a minute hour your spiritual daughters. Father, you're seeking out your spiritual midwives. In the name of Jesus Christ. Come on, let's end this by coming to the altar. Let's end this by coming.